Hi everyone, and welcome to our last session of the week, this Co-Creating Change Festival that's been online and live from Monday to Friday. And I'm just really delighted that we are ending the festival thinking about evaluation, and we've got Suzanne Burns here and Andy Curtis. This session is captioned and the link is in the right. I'm going to hand over. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Sarah. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this final session of the Co-Creating Change Festival. It's really nice to see you here for the final hour on a Friday, and I'm sure you'll all appreciate the end at 5 o'clock, where you can disappear off somewhere for a nice glass of wine. I'm Suzanne Burns. I'm an independent consultant, and I've been working with Battersea Arts Centre on the evaluation of the Co-Creating Change Network for the last two and a bit years. And it's in that capacity that I'm speaking this afternoon as an independent, but also having led the evaluation of the network. I am a mid-60s woman with my hair dragged back, pink hairband, spectacles, purple sweatshirt, and I've got Mr. Scruff in the background. And I'm going to be in conversation for the next 40 minutes or so with Andy Curtis, and we will then end with a discussion and a Q&A. So, Andy, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Andy Curtis. I'm Research Evaluation Manager at Paul Hamlyn Foundation. I've been there for about 2.5 years. And I think it's just worth noting, prior to that, I was an evaluator in the charity non-profit sector for a good, you know, dozen years before that. So I'm certainly on the other side of the table sometimes to where I used to be.
Great, thank you. And Andy, you're sitting with your headphones in, spectacles on, and a COVID growth, slight growth, perhaps?
Yeah. What's the point of shaving in a pandemic is my attitude.
Well, precisely. Yeah, exactly. Anyway, so good afternoon, everyone. So if I can just kick off, we're going to try and keep this conversation relatively informal, just to sort of explore, I suppose, the intention was to try to explore some maybe trends in evaluation, any new approaches that Andy can identify, maybe sort of looking at the impact of COVID a little bit too on how we're evaluating our work. So my first question to you, Andy, is really just to get you to talk a little bit. You've already alluded to your own experience in evaluation, but to talk about your approach to evaluation and learning and maybe how that's changed over time. And then, you know, what kind of trends, changes you're seeing in the practice?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's quite, in preparation for this, I suddenly realised, I suppose it's just my age. I've worked in a lot of places, et cetera. So I won't bore you with all the stops on that journey. I do think I want to just reflect very quickly that, you know, I was an academic. I did a PhD. It's just reflecting for this session, so that was about 20 years ago. There wasn't really much talk about evaluation in the sense that we do it in the sector, if you like. It made me think that in terms of, like, you talk about an approach to an evaluation, a lot of the, I kind of did a sociology politics PhD, which kind of grounded me in a certain way for certain research methods or qualitative, quantitative, etc. But I didn't, through that particular experience, I didn't I wasn't really introduced to what I would now, or in the sector, use as evaluation approaches, funnily enough, although they were very peripheral. Maybe it was like one week on a module 20 years ago. It was just a very brief reflection on that ahead of this session. It was interesting that, as that's such a major career route for researchers who don't go into academia, it's interesting that didn't figure prominently. And my first kind of job in terms of evaluations, I mean, well, first of all, I worked at what was then the Institute of Education, which is linked to UCL. So we worked on the kind of projects that were kind of evaluating, not necessarily the official evaluations, for example, the Academy Schools Programme, which was new at the time. Started under new Labour government. And then I shifted to what was then the Community Development Foundation, which was, didn't like to call itself a quango, but it was a quango, community development. And So that was my kind of first experience of being in charge of predominantly commissioning evaluations and doing evaluations ourselves of predominantly, as it was, New Labour funded government projects. And the interesting thing is the organisation itself conducted that work and we evaluated it. So I know some people would see that relationship as potentially problematic. It was separately commissioned. So in terms of a particular methodology, there wasn't a sort of set methodology in the organisation. I think the Community Development Foundation at the time had some very interesting approaches. But it wasn't like for every single evaluation we would choose those. On the bonfire of the Quangos, et cetera, and time moved on, I went to NCVO. So that's where the bulk of my career has been in the last 10 years, the National Council for Voluntary Organisations. And I was in the Institute for Volunteering Research. So predominantly we bid for projects that had any volunteering element in. And again, so it wasn't a set methodology. Sometimes it would be down to the commissioners. I did some very interesting projects there. Just a couple of examples about how diverse it was. One was around people with offending histories and volunteering and the possible benefits of volunteering for people with offending histories. I also, for the Motor Neuron Disease Association, looked at their association volunteers, which is a particular volunteer, type of volunteer who works with people living with MND. So, you know, really, I've met some incredible, you know, aside from the research and evaluation, it's taken me to some really interesting places geographically across the UK, and also met some very interesting, very brave people. And so I had all that experience. Then I was at Local Trust briefly, which you mentioned earlier in your earlier talk, which is more place-based funding. And then I ended up at Paul Hamlyn Foundation. So funny enough, they commissioned a project I had done a few years ago or worked on. So it was interesting then being the other side. So now I am predominantly, though I've always, in some of my jobs, had the role of commissioner or sometimes larger projects, say, subcontracting a survey. This is the first time my role is predominantly commissioning evaluations, for example, of particular funds we have. And my own kind of primary research is sort of lessened in this role. So in that time, yeah, I haven't had one single kind of approach to evaluation. Methodologically, I would say I'm sort of stronger qualitatively. That's the way I've kind of tended to sit in research teams. On smaller projects, as we often do, I've done both. I can do quantitative research to a certain level. So that's kind of how it's been. And it's just very interesting now sort of being at an organization that also emphasizes learning as much as evaluation. And we'll probably talk about this a bit more, which is, you know, changed even more in the last couple of years with COVID.
Yeah. I was just going to ask you, actually, could you distinguish your job title is Research and Evaluation Manager, and you've you've talked about research, you've talked about evaluation, now you've introduced the term learning. I'm just wondering how you would distinguish between those three words in terms of
In terms of job titles, I think as ever they tend to lag. I think, you know, the team I'm in is the evidence and learning team. So this is not sort of awkward answer. I think in some ways the job title is a kind of historic one in a way. Though research and evaluation is indeed a part of my role. I mean, it's always been, since I've been at Paul Hamlyn Foundation, and it was largely driven by the former director of evidence and learning, Jane Steele, this kind of emphasis on learning. So beyond these kind of doesn't have to be siloed reports or individual reports or evaluations of a particular time frame. You know, an emphasis on being a learning organisation, a learning funder itself, but also encouraging those we fund to be learning organisations. So you're quite right. It's not in the job title, but it's quite a sort of dominant part of my role.
It just seems interesting because I think that's one of the biggest shifts that I personally have seen maybe over the last, I don't know, I've been self-employed since 2004 and been carrying out evaluation over that 17-year period. And I guess for me, that's one of the biggest shifts is the move from a more kind of monitoring and accountability based approach to a learning based approach. And I think Paul Hamlyn Foundation has been the spearhead of that, really, in some ways. Is that one of the things that you feel you've seen happening? And are there any other trends or shifts that you've seen over that varied experience?
Yeah, I think, people talk about like the Whig view of history, isn't it? This kind of false view that like, you know, everything shifts or in a linear way from one point to another. I've seen certainly lots of different trends, and that's, some of them have been smaller trends, which I think we talked about beforehand. I won't dwell on them now, but they're kind of very reminiscent when I was bidding for projects of methodological fashion. So going back 10 years, a lot of commissioners, when we were bidding for projects, would talk about social return on investment. Nothing wrong with that particular methodology. It just seemed to be everywhere for a moment. And in some projects, even projects I was commissioned on, it didn't seem particularly appropriate. It just seemed to be a fashion. Randomized controlled trials came into types of evaluations. Again, you a long established, very important methodology. Again, not always appropriate for those projects. Also, creative methods, the middle part of the decade, I found on the projects, which again, all of these methods in themselves are brilliant, like photo diaries, video diaries. But sometimes they were totally inappropriate for the project, because everyone's like, oh, this sounds good. Let's commission something with this as an add-on. So all of those are methodologies which are really interesting when they're appropriately used and kind of at the center of the project, not added on for the... The trend. I mean, as for the kind of the broader shifts to learning, it's hard for me to tell, and I hope that's not an unhelpful answer. I've gone to Paul Hamlyn Foundation, which has this particular take on learning, and I think it's helped drive that shift towards it. Sometimes people talk about being in the bubble, so there's a lot of peer funders I'm often in the room with, or my peers, say, for example, Esme Fairbairn, the Lloyds Bank Foundation, just to name two off the top of my head, or City Bridge Trust too, where they seem to be very much on that kind of same page. So it's quite hard for me to know in some ways if, I know there's other funders out there that haven't necessarily emphasized learning in the same way in the last few years. So for me, it feels like both in terms of my career and in this kind of immediate circle of funders or peers from funders in this immediate circle, there seems to be this shift. Sometimes it's hard to tell what that's like sector wide.
Yeah. You use the term appropriate, and it that jumped out at me, in the context of this sort of evaluation bingo thing where, there are buzzwords and trends, and you use the word appropriate. How would you define that in terms of looking at it from the point of view of you as a funder when you're looking at evaluation processes that people are putting in place? What do you deem to be appropriate? Is it?
I think it's a difficult one, and actually, I suppose to be sort of very self-reflective or self-critical, I think. Even as a fund and some of the things we commission, we kind of fall back on, I want to say established methods. So it may be focus groups or a survey of a particular cohort of grantees. For some of those different methods, I think, I know, for example, so this is before Paul Hamlyn Foundation, when I worked on a project with photo diaries, it just wasn't, I mean, I was a funder in London, and we had the two case study projects. One was in Liverpool, one was in Devon. And there wasn't really time assigned with the project to work with the local community to kind of build up that kind of trust and that kind of conversation. And the budget was there, which we gave people, a bunch of people, cameras and told them to do this. But there wasn't that, as the methodology normally asks for, that you have that kind of time and relationship. But I think going back to this whole issue of, so I suppose it's co-creation or at least a participatory element of the research. I remember talking to you know, the contacts in Liverpool in particular, where people just didn't want to do photo diaries. You got given a camera for free. You know, there wasn't, it wasn't like there wasn't a benefit. They just, it's not really our thing. You know, this doesn't, you know, we would love to talk about it. I mean, it's about volunteering in Liverpool at a particular time. It's really interesting. Using photo diaries, those particular people it just wasn't their thing. They weren't interested in it. Yeah. So the right way to do that methodology was not 3 years before that point, have an advisory group where people say, oh, you're going to do photo diaries as an add-on. It would be, you know, involving those people in those communities about, you know, we want to do this research, what would be the best methods, all the kind of things you were talking about in the session before this one as well, to some extent. So I think that was a lesson too.
So it's appropriate to the participants, isn't it, to the people, you know, who you're working with to evaluate a project, but also appropriate to context and resources. There's the whole notion of proportionality as well. You know, sometimes I think scaling of projects can be huge in comparison to the actual size of the project. So it's about it being appropriate to all of those different things, isn't it? It's in my experience as well. You talked before about the impact of COVID, and I'd maybe like to move on a little bit to that. And I'm wondering how COVID has affected my work. You know, as an evaluator, I've really had to develop my toolkit. I've really had to, you know, some of the old tools just were no use. I had to develop new ones to look at different kinds of delivery models. And I know that, you know, Paul Hamlyn Foundation's been very, very flexible with its grantees, because I do a lot of evaluation development support work for you. So I'm just wondering, from your perspective, you know, how you feel COVID might affect evaluation and our approaches to evaluation and learning into the longer term. Do you think it might have any longer term impact, or do you think we might just go back to the old ways? What's your feeling on that?
I think we're kind of in that point. I don't want to call it a tipping point. I mean, who knows where we... So just to unpack that a little, I think, you know, that... And I'm going to talk about monitoring a bit as well. And I'm not conflating monitoring with evaluation totally. I'm acknowledging the difference. But for both monitoring and evaluation, there's been this conversation, you know, happening for a long time in the sector, particularly the Institute for Voluntary Action Research, IVA, who particularly talk about with core-funded organisations about, you know, even challenging the notion that they should do an individual report for funders. You know, if you core-fund an organisation, they should just send you their annual report, for example, instead of sending eight reports to eight different funders. It's a really, you know, nuanced, interesting line of thought. Then you get to COVID, where the emphasis is, say, particularly for someone like Paul Hamlyn Foundation, where we gave out, over the course of COVID, 400 grants, emergency grants. I think the most of those were these kind of, not no questions asked, but low prescriptive, £20,000 was kind of seen as the threshold where trust, you know, with a reasonable level of due diligence, due diligence obviously, but in terms of making that award quickly, £20,000, and without too much reporting, and by extension, evaluation, not really having an evaluation of those, bearing in mind those were emergency grants, quite often helping organizations capacity, keep going. So that, I think that's been a, I mean, obviously that is leaning more towards the monitoring aspect. So it is interesting, when we got to the point where those grants finished, I thought, oh, is this the point where we are now going to be asked to then do a disproportionate amount of monitoring? And we haven't. So obviously we need organizations to report on that. It's been a lot more light touch than some of our other grants have been traditionally. Not that it's ever been overly onerous, I would argue. I think so. The question is, I suppose, for the learning going forwards, is will we and other, as I say, peers in other funders, you know, having this conversation of, is it a case of we did that during an emergency period for a particular period of time, when we reopened funds, or all our funds have reopened and reopened some time ago, that how much of that will be reflected in the requirements for these new grants? I would say for the Paul Hamlyn Foundation, it's not change, bearing in mind we didn't have a hugely over, particularly in terms of evaluation, you're in the scheme, Susanne, you know, where we fund consultants to work with organisations to kind of think and design evaluation activities. For larger grants, that might be hiring an actual evaluator. Sometimes it's just working on their internal processes. So in some ways, it hasn't changed greatly.
No.
But there is, going back to your question for the question before, it's interesting that even that scheme, and it's not just about the language or rebranding. It used to be the evaluation support scheme, and now it's the evidence and learning scheme. And that does, it's not just a shift in the language, it is particularly, and I think just to give a couple of tangible examples, that scheme is always tied traditionally to what the money was funding. And yeah. During the emergency period, it could be anything in the organisation, any learning process. So some people kind of even use those consultants to look at more strategic questions in their organisation during a crisis. So it kind of became a much broader support.
Yeah.
Now we've gone back to making grants again. I would say we have kind of scaled down the focus of that again, but it's not gone back to how it was, which was an evaluation support scheme. So it has narrowed the focus slightly to the work that we're funding, but I would argue it hasn't really gone back to how it was before. So some change, but not total change, if you see what I mean. Yeah.
No, that's really interesting. I mean, you know, just for anybody listening in the session, the Paul Hamlyn Foundation scheme is a fantastic scheme where a couple of days of support, evaluation support, what was evaluation support, now evidence and learning support, are given to grantees and paid for directly by the Paul Hamlyn Foundation. And I think it's made a massive difference to the sector in all sorts of ways, in terms of building capacity and just ingraining, embedding different approaches to evaluation. I think credit to the foundation for having, you know, implemented that kind of, I suppose, flying doctor-y type scheme, really, you know, because every piece of work I've done on it has been different. There's never been two pieces of work that have been the same. And that's really challenging for us as evaluators as well, you know, to really kind of practice and hone our skills. So it's worked in a range of different directions. I think it's been successful. So just so people know that about what the scheme was that we were talking about. Mm-hmm. I think what the point you make about the lighter touch is really important. And I do hope that, you know, moving on from where we currently are, I mean, we're never going to be post-COVID. We'll get to a point, hopefully, where it's endemic and we can live with it. But I'm hoping that, you know, the lighter touch approaches that we've seen can be retained to some extent and achieve that degree of what you were saying, appropriateness and proportionality, you know, which would be interesting. Just to sort of move on a little bit, I'd like to ask, you drew the distinction between monitoring and evaluation, and I'd like to ask who you think we evaluate for. Because monitoring implies you're evaluating for someone else. Mm-hmm. It's your accountability. So who do we evaluate for?
I think this is such a key question. And as I say, you know, Jane Steele, who developed so much of the thinking at PHF over the last decade in this, is, you know, very much, you know, the evaluation is for the grantee. Mm-hmm. And for want of a better term, our approach at PHF, and this is when I say some people struggle, not so much internally, but when I talk about the approach at conferences, some people find quite difficult, is we don't aggregate the evaluations, if you like. So in a, you know, we have so many different funds, but even in a particular, you know, arts-based learning fund, for instance, you wouldn't get the X number of grantees from that year, say 40, and you know, try to aggregate from the evaluations that have completed that year. So the evaluation is for the grantee. Mm-hmm. And so I think that the two elements of that is, one is asking the question, so it's not for us, though the findings have shared with the grant manager. But the second point is, then we don't try to sort of claim that, again, for want of a better term, aggregated impact. So we don't say, well, we've, you know, we there's this kind of you know, particular way of evaluating, and across the 40 grantees, you know, we funded this, you know, that's our aggregate impact. And I know some funders do that. I think sometimes that approach might be appropriate on certain schemes or helpful, depending what the broader audiences are. Mm. I think on those particular funds, it wouldn't be useful to try and, even if you'd say it's credible to try and aggregate that impact, we don't. So the evaluations for the grantee, though we are interested in the learning.
Mm-hmm. I guess where it's aggregated, where funders tend to aggregate, it tends to be in the output, in the area of outputs, doesn't it? And the quantitative rather than the qualitative. Do you think that's a fair assessment?
Yeah, I'm trying to, and again, someone always believes in debate and whatever, because obviously I lean to the more light touch element myself. I think there are good examples probably where you might want to aggregate, or it's appropriate to aggregate. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to think off the top of my head. You know, I mean, I mentioned.
I'm thinking about employment statistics.
Yeah.
Freelancers, or I don't know, you know, or diversity stats.
Yeah, I mean, it depends what the program was trying to do. I mean, I mentioned researching with ex-offenders a while back. So this particular research wasn't in that way, but sometimes research in that area, because of the audience, i.e. the commissioners, will go down to that because of this intervention, it's... Yeah. Reduced the likelihood to re-offend. I know some people would criticize that methodology, but in that case, what it's trying to do is speak to a certain audience, and mm-hmm. I think that's absolutely fine. It's making sure who are the people that will respond to the research, what language mm-hmm. do they talk about. So sometimes you might use not necessarily methodologies you disagree with. I don't think that would ever work, but you might mm-hmm. have an emphasis in the work you use that you wouldn't ordinarily do, unless you weren't trying to talk to, I mean, I suppose quite often in that case, it would be a government audience or a policy audience.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? And it does take us to the sort of the difference that you were talking about earlier as well, between the qualitative and the quantitative in a way, and, you know, where the different things are relevant. It was a recent conference, and Kuli Tirai actually said about evaluation that the small stories are the big stories. And that really resonated with me, you know, because it was kind of drawing attention to the qualitative dimensions of our learning as being the big things. You know, the numbers are kind of smaller things. The big things were the stories. And I like the way the stories and the narratives, I like the emphasis that she put on that. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on the balance between qualitative and quantitative, because of course together they do make a holistic approach to evaluation, but you know, any thoughts on the balance, relative balance, does it differ with different kinds of projects or different audiences? Might you shift your reporting or communication for different audiences between one and the other? I don't know, what are your thoughts on that balance between the two?
I think all things being equal, I would normally like, as I say, because I'm ingrained and I'm of a certain generation of researcher, I would have both. But it's again, I've talked about appropriateness a lot, and often with PHF, you know, our cohorts or our funds still quite small. So we had a new strategy in 2015, for instance, and there was an evaluation, which meant all of our funds, as they are now, started at least that date, or some of them started slightly later in their current form. When we commissioned an evaluation for the Ideas and Pioneers Fund, I think at that point there'd only been 100 grants made. So when you're talking about a survey, and I think there was a survey on that evaluation, but it was more around sampling and you know, it wasn't a survey necessarily, because we couldn't even use that whole 100. It was those who had completed their grants, which I think was down to about 60. So on another project, for instance, as I said, you know, in the past I've worked on these kind of larger government funded grants programs where you know, you're into thousands of beneficiaries, or certainly hundreds. a survey would make a lot of sense. There's what you could get, the benefits you could get from a survey. Yeah. You're not running out qualitative, because I would always have qualitative research in there too. But then, that the opportunities you'd get from a survey in that instance is is different, isn't it, to with a very small sample. So again, it's what's appropriate for the project, I would say.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, isn't it? It is, again, the proportionality and the appropriateness. One of the other things that you kind of is implicit in what we're talking about around this appropriateness is, and the purpose, I suppose, of evaluation is around whether the purpose is for the end, the evaluation, i.e. the report, whoever that's targeted at, or whether it is the evaluation process. Do we focus more on evaluations, as in reports or outputs, to the detriment, perhaps, of our learning, our evaluation process and how we learn? And I'm kind of interested in any thoughts you might have on that.
I think, again, like traditionally most jobs I've worked in, it's been that focusing on a particular output to the detriment of learning. I think, again, that's, though not consistently, I've often worked on, where you evaluate a grants program that's 2 years long. It's interesting that then, but that affects everything, doesn't it? All the staff involved are on fixed term contracts. To the learning right through, and it is almost the evaluation is almost like this fixed point at the end. You're evaluating a program that ran from here to here. So sometimes this is slightly, again, showing my age, in healthier economic times, maybe this was more at the start of my career, that there could be impact from the evaluation in the sense of whether the fund would be extended. But by the time you got to the final report anyway, that decision would have been made either way. So it's quite often in that particular cycle, the interim report seemed to carry greater weight. I think, someone like Paul Hamlyn Foundation, these funds, run on beyond the evaluation. So each fund that's had an evaluation, as I say, most date from 2015, they weren't all operational from that point. So the Ideas and Pioneers Fund, which, as I say, reported last year, so it looked at the first 4 or 5 years of the fund, but the fund remained open. So it, and changed during the course of the evaluation. Some influenced by the information coming out the evaluation, and some changes happened separately from that. So, it's not those, as I say, sometimes there is a project or a program where, the evaluation is fixed term, it's monitoring a particular thing, but certainly a funder, unless you're closing the fund or it's a temporary fund, the evaluation is just one part of a longer journey, like a learning journey.
It's an interesting one, isn't it, because it's the formative and the summative thing that I was talking about earlier in the workshop. But being really clear at the beginning whether where your emphasis is going to sit can be quite important. Is your emphasis on getting this glitzy report at the end, or is it actually about how the learning informs the process and, contributes to improvement in the project? I think, quite often they're the kind of conversations that I have when I'm providing evaluation support or learning evidence and learning support to grantees. It's an important set of questions. Kind of linked to that is this thing about the how. I found, and this has been something that it's taken quite a while, I think, for me to reach a greater degree of clarity on it, but I've found that in carrying out evaluation, a lot of the time, the focus has been on the impact, on the fact that the well-being has improved, or that children's confidence has improved, or that families are communicating better as a group. So the emphasis has been on the impact. And I've kind of begun to realize over the last number of years, quite a lot of years, that what we were missing in a lot of the time in our evaluation processes and our evidence gathering was, what is it that we're actually doing that achieves that? In other words, the how rather than the impact, the how rather than the what. you know, what were the strategies that we used in a classroom or in a workshop that actually engendered more confidence? So, you know, how important is focusing on the how as well as the outcome or the impact to you? You know, the methods, the approaches, the processes.
I mean, I think it's incredibly important, and I think sometimes it's hard to capture. I'm not saying it can't be captured, and I think you're quite right. It's not always the focus of evaluations. I think just as a quick example of our own foundation for the Ideas and Pioneers Fund, one thing that changed on there. This wasn't actually part of an evaluation, but it drew on learning from the evaluation we did have. Was it wasn't a particularly diverse fund either in terms of age or in terms of ethnicity. And it has totally changed over the course of 2 years in terms of, you know, the profile of both applicants and grantees, which is a really positive step. So in some ways on that, it what's really positive is the change has been seen. It's tangible. It's you know, but you know, a lot of work went into trying to attract a different audience to apply. And you know, and that's followed through to grantees too. So in a way, if you like, the impact or the what you could argue is the important stuff, yeah, it's happened and it's measurable. I'm not saying we don't know how. There's obviously we tried a number of different things. I say the Royal We, you know, a lot of thought went into those kind of from the communication strategies, mm-hmm. from the grant side, and what we in that case. We've captured some, and I would argue we probably haven't captured the full learning of what happened there to help yeah. create that success, yeah. and which is really important.
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot about, you know, the arts and health context. I mean, we know that the arts are important in a health environment, you know, in all sorts of different ways, whether it's mental health, whether it's, you know, dementia, Parkinson's. We know that they have an important role to play. But I'm not convinced that we've explored the how yet as much as we possibly could. So it's just an interesting kind of dimension to it. I wanted to move on just briefly to something that Moira Sinclair kind of said to me once, which really, it just stuck with me. You know how sometimes somebody says something and it kind of changes your whole approach. I was evaluating the In Harmony Liverpool project and have been doing for the last 12 years, which is incredible in itself, you know, such a longitudinal project. And I was struggling, you know, with notions of attribution, you know, to what extent can you actually attribute a particular outcome to your particular intervention? Because we do that all the time. We say, you know, we've done this, we're leading this dance project and these children are now much more confident or they have greater aspiration. And I've struggled for a long time with that concept of attribution. And Moira said to me once, she said, it's not about attribution, it's about contribution. And it really stuck with me. And I went, of course, you know, you can only ever make a contribution to something through your arts cultural intervention. And a little boy, one of my case study children in the In Harmony project, Callum, actually came into a termly session when we were still doing face-to-face before the lockdown. And he came in and he was jumping up and down. He was so excited, really excited to talk to me and tell me that term so much had improved for him. You know, he was getting his writing had improved. He was much better with hand-eye coordination in all sorts of ways. And his bowing was better as a result. And everything was just going brilliantly. And I'm looking at this little boy and thinking, he looks different. He looks different. And then Callum turned around and he said, but you know what? That could all be because I've got my new glasses. And I kind of thought, you know, isn't that beautiful? You know, there was a contribution that music was playing, but actually this little boy recognized contribution rather than attribution. And yeah, So I wanted to throw that in as a kind of precursor to a quick fire thing around binaries, because I do think evaluation is surrounded by these binaries, attribution or contribution. Stop worrying about, you know, attribution, just care about the contribution. And I wanted to just end before we open up for some questions with a few of these binaries to fire at you, Andy. And the first one is the title that we've given really to this conversation. You know, is evaluation learning? Is it an imposition or is it an opportunity for learning?
Oh, goodness me. It's an opportunity for learning, I'd say.
When does it become an imposition?
I think if no one close to the, I keep on referring to projects, I'm aware sometimes it can be a broader work or just an organization doing its day-to-day activities. If no one is learning, or even not using the word learning, getting anything from participating in these evaluation-learning activities, it's not useful, basically. If it's just to produce this product or tick a box, then it's not useful, I would argue.
Yeah. Formative or summative?
I'm not allowed to say both, am I?
they
both have their uses in different contexts, I'd say.
Judgment or assessment?
God, I think the right answer would be to say you should never make a judgment without some substantiation. But I think judgments obviously come in all the time. And I think particularly work at the moment on DEI in particular are kind of judgments and prejudices which go throughout obviously all the work we do. But Dartington Trust is doing interesting work about, you know, how research evaluation, you know, particularly through an anti-racist lens, you know, how a lot of that work is historically problematic. So really interesting. So that's not quite answering your question, but just being aware of the judgments and, you know, I must have done and places I've worked brought to certain projects, or even just using methodologies unquestioningly or concepts.
It might actually be both. You might be making judgments in order to make a better assessment, mightn't you, as well? Future focused or retrospective?
I'd say retrospective in some ways, in order to be future focused. What's the point of looking back unless it has some implications for the future?
Yeah. I mean, there's no real such thing, is there, as a binary? Not if you look at it in a kind of thoughtful way. I think there's only Peppa Pig that looks at things in a kind of binary way. And my final one, which kind of, I think, resonates in the context of the co-creating change network, which seems like a nice way to sort of end the conversation before we open up to questions. To or with?
I mean, it should always be with, but I think this is the thing. I don't want to just give the right answer. I would say in my career, and including some of the a lot of the work we do now, it's often to, and it's the with has not been a strong enough element, or absent in many cases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely needs to be strengthened. I've become more aware over the last however many years of the need to be sharing back as well. Mm. You know, We involve people in our evaluative processes and our learning and reflection, but a lot of the time that's not fed back. And, you know, I think that's a really important, it's not just creating it with people, creating a framework with people, it's also about how you report that back and how you share it back so that your learning shared back with the people who've contributed to it. It feels really important to me. Seems to be a stage that we do miss out on, often because of capacity, actually. Andy, thank you so much. You've been really open. I want to just open it up to any questions. If people would like to post questions in the Q&A or comments, thoughts, responses, we do have one already. I'm interested if either of you have ever experienced an evaluation which concludes the co-created project got it really wrong, and in fact did damage to or within a community, and what happens then? And that's a question from Tom from the Co-Creating Change Network. Do you want to go first, Andy?
I can't think of one off the top of my head. So I'll hand to you.
I can't think of one off the top of my head that has been that extreme, but I can think of projects where something has gone wrong in them and some damage has been done, and where having had an embedded approach to evaluation and reflection and learning within the project, they've been able to correct and get back on track. I can think of examples of that. And I think that's probably the key, that probably if you do embed a reflective approach into a program of work, then in a sense, it can allow you to hedge off the failure, the thing that you're alluding to there, Tom. You know, if you get it really wrong and it does damage, then, you know, hopefully you can head that off at the pass if your approach to evaluation is built into the project in a formative way and can prevent it from going badly wrong, that you can nip it in the bud. And maybe that's as strong an argument as anything for having a more embedded, formative, iterative approach to evaluation. And I can think of examples of that, but I can't actually think of one that would be the real extreme. Mm. That would be my response.
Well, I want to jump in. It's not about the bad evaluation, but I'm thinking about even within this network, Susanne, I think artists and organisations, when they've received funding, even from an organisation like BAC, and they're involved in an evaluation process, even when they're asked the question, you know, how is it going? It's embedded that during that process, because there's probably a hierarchy and they're worried about saying the wrong thing, but it's quite often not until afterwards that someone says, oh, I wish it had been like this, or I didn't enjoy that, or that wasn't really working. And I've often thought, but we asked that question, and I wonder if it's about that worry about, well, hang on, I've just received a commission or something, so I don't want to say, I don't think this is working very well. And I don't really know how we break that, but I have seen that happen quite often, that when you get to the final session, someone says, this wasn't working for me. You think, we asked you that question. And I think it's about trust and hierarchies.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely bang on. I'm going to nip in and then let Andy answer that, because I think that's absolutely on the you've hit the nail on the head. And I think there's a culture of resisting talking about failure in our sector, because we don't want to talk about things that don't work. We want to talk about the things that did work, and then the stuff that doesn't work, the things that we wish we hadn't done or that we'd done differently, we keep to ourselves and we don't share that. And so of course other people have the same pitfalls, so somehow we have to break that culture. And I think that's what Layla and David's project, the Fail Space project, has actually been addressing, and has addressed really well. How do we talk about failure, and how do we learn from failure? Because we know that that's what we learn from most in our everyday lives, don't we? You know, when something doesn't work, that's where your best learning comes from. Andy, do you want to come back on that?
Yeah, I mean, two things very quickly that kind of come up before, but I don't think either of these would address it fully. One is having a fully independent evaluator. So that's been an issue I've had in the past, as I've mentioned, where you've had a team in an organization evaluating the grant making in the different part of the same organization. I think also methodologically, going back to one advantage of quantitative is you can, though it doesn't always present in this way, you can have the options of collecting anonymous feedback, which can be more critical, which qualitative, sometimes you can't have quite so many barriers in. On the other hand, with qualitative research, obviously you can build trust throughout the interview, and those voices can be anonymized afterwards, but it doesn't quite address, I'm aware of this kind of power issue running through the question and trust. And, you know, it's difficult, and it's also difficult for, you know, the evaluators conducting the work. I think on, that kind of whole concept of embracing, even using the word failure, and it's something we talked a lot about at PHF. Yeah. And I think I know we had several funds where one was exploring tests which ran through, which you would know, Susanne, and Ideas and Pioneers, where actually the kind of failure, potential failure element was much more at the forefront, because in essence you were testing an idea. Mm-hmm. And I think that's quite a positive way, but obviously not all work's going to be like that. Sometimes you are trying to achieve something, mm-hmm. and the fact you didn't achieve it, it's not a good, it's a shame, if you like, and it's then trying to get the learning out of that, and it is very difficult with all the power dynamics and the role of self-censorship and everything. So it's a really hard one to address, I think.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. You know, I always say, if I'm doing evaluation training, I always say that there are two critical questions. And the first one is what works, and the second one is what works less well. And that avoids the use of the language of failure, but it's trying to surface the things that are actually less successful. And it's perhaps a safer question than talking around failure. But it's a challenge, because it's ingrained in the competitive funding culture. It's ingrained. Mm. And Andy's right, I think. It's about power.
Yeah. One thing I would say just very quickly about when I worked in place-based work, particularly at local trust, pre-COVID, where you'd be going to an organization, so not an organization, you'd be going to an area and it's their space. And, you know, I do really love this country. I've been to so many different parts of it, and people don't. It's interesting in that kind of environment where you've got, in those cases, quite often, you know, community organizations or organizations at the front line, you know, it's not in the London head office, it's not over the phone. People never held back. You know, when I was a young researcher, I did that kind of research on and off for many years. You know, it was difficult, but it was great. You know, people sometimes, you know, that involved literally going into people's homes, and, you know, one minute people would make a cup of tea and the next minute, yeah, they wouldn't care about those kind of power dynamics. But quite often in that line of work, your community development and place-based funding, they weren't attached to formal organizations, which I don't know if that helped too. So certainly, you know, I know we've probably done to death, all of us, the benefits of digital and the downsides of digital. I think one downside is that, you know, I've had some jobs where I've gone across the country just for a 2 or 3 hour meeting. You know, it's not now everyone can use Zoom. No, it's not seen as time effective. But on the other hand, you know, that I hope that hasn't gone forever, because I think in some cases or some types of funding, just going to people's own space. So, you know, so you're entering their space. I think there is a difference in power dynamic. It's quite hard to measure that, but it's been tangible throughout my career. And I think it'd be a shame to lose that.
Yeah, it's an interesting point. It kind of connects to something Inez has posted in the chat. She says, I think this is where funders doing peer support sessions with different grantees can be really valuable. Our fund at AHRC did this, and it's helped us to be much more honest with them. So it's building that trust as well, not just with participants, but building that trust with your funder. She's in a group of grantees from a particular fund. We meet quarterly with the funder to share progress and challenges across our projects. And in a sense, Sarah, that's what we've been trying to do with the CCC grants, with the commissions, isn't it? To build that cohort and that openness and trust within the cohort, where they're able to talk about things. And there's another point here, which I think is a really valid one. Maybe wondering if COVID, where things have had to change radically, sometimes on projects, whether that's made us a little bit more comfortable with being open about outcomes not being met in the way that we expected and hoped. I think that goes full circle back really to what you were saying, Andy, about whether, you know, we can retain some of the good things, you know, from the learning that's coming out of COVID as we move forward. I don't have any more questions, and we are 4 minutes off the end. So I'm going to say thank you to Andy for having the conversation with me. And I'm going to pass it back to Sarah to wrap us all up.
with a warm blanket and a hot toddy. I'd just like to say a huge thank you, Susanne, go away, my daughter. She personally, for being a critical friend throughout this whole process, I've really appreciated your support, and feels like this was a really good session to end the entire festival on. And I can see there are names of people who've been here with us all week, so I'd like to say a massive thank you for still being here at 5 o'clock, and we all finish exactly on 5 o'clock. And I think it'd be pertinent to thank our funders, including Paul Hamlyn Foundation, Arts Council, and Kalous Gulbenkian. The work that you have funded has been really important and continues to be really important. And we're going to have a banging evaluation for you, including things that didn't work, but things that really did. And I think I'm going to say that's a wrap.